Hello friends, now I will be talking to you about Zollinger-Ellison syndrome. In ZES, it is a non-beta cell tumor. And this tumor secretes large amount of gastrin, which lead to increased secretion of gastric acid. So that lead to hyperacidity, and because of high amount of gastrin, there is parietal cell hyperplasia occur, and that is the infect which lead to high amount of acid in the stomach. A high amount of acid in the stomach is definitely a very strong predisposition for peptic ulceration. Now, regarding the pathology, this is one tumor which can be both benign and malignant. It is benign in around 40% cases, malignant in around 60% cases. And one more hallmark of the disease is, of the tumor is, highly variable size. The size may be as low as 2 millimeter to 20 centimeter. Now, what is the site? Most common site is duodenum. It is in around 50% of the cases. In around 25% cases, it is located in the pancreas, and it may be a part of MEN1 syndrome, multiple endocrine neoplasia 1, in around 20% cases. And one of the hallmark of MEN is when we suspect, if you get hypercalcemia in a case of Zollinger-Ellison syndrome, you should always suspect about multiple endocrine neoplasia 1 syndrome. Now, what are the clinical features? As I told you, patient has peptic ulcer, so pain, abdomen and GI bleed, what we see in a case of non-Zollinger-Ellison syndrome peptic ulcer. But you cannot diagnose a ZES unless you do the endoscopy. Okay, now you have done the endoscopy. When you will suspect that patient has ZES, if you are getting multiple ulcers, large ulcers, maybe more than 1 to 2 centimeter size, or ulcer in abnormal places, maybe in jejunum, not responding to treatment, or recurrence after, treatment. All these are the strong clue that patient may have Zollinger-Ellison syndrome. Diarrhea, because large amount of acid neutralizes the lipase and that produces diarrhea. In 20% cases, diarrhea may precede the pain abdomen. And of course, I told you patient may come with MEN1 syndrome, patient has feature of parathyroid also, and metastasis occur in around 30% of the cases. Well, one more special feature of Zollinger-Ellison syndrome is that in this patient, there is increase in the somatostatin receptor in the abdomen. This is a special feature which we use in the investigation also. Now, how we diagnose? First of all, we do endoscopy, is mandatory. Endoscopic finding, I have told you, these are finding which strongly suspect toward the Zorringer-Allison syndrome. But remember, with just endoscopy, you cannot confirm the diagnosis of Zorringer-Allison syndrome. So, what we do to confirm? Of course, in this patient, you check the gastrin level, they are high, gastric acid level are high, and basic acid output, maximum output ratio is more than 0.6, and that is one indicator that gastrin level is and acid level are very high. But the most sensitive and the most specific test is secretin injection test. This is the most sensitive and most specific test or diagnostic test. So you give injection secretin and you see response after 15 minutes. What is the response? In a normal person, gastrin level goes down and acid output level goes down. This is what we see in a normal person. But in Zorringer-Allison, no change. Despite giving secretin, gastrin level is remain normal, it remain high, and acid level also high, they do not come down. That is the most sensitive and most specific test. So, what I was telling you, the gastrin level remain more than 200 picogram within 15 minutes of secretin injection is the diagnostic test. Now, this confirmed the diagnosis of Zorringer-Allison syndrome. But now you have to locate the tumor also. For tumor location, we go for endoscopic ultrasound. It is just like doing echocardiography for any cardiac lesion. So, just like echocardiography. CT MRI are done again to locate the tumor. But if your CT or MRI are also normal, then you go for somatostatin receptor scintigraphy, your so called nuclear octreotide scan. I told you somatostatin level are also increased in this, and it also detect the metastasis also. Remember, metastasis is there in around 30% of the cases. So, tumor location is mandatory because future plan, treatment plan depend on this only. So, now patient has come to us. All patients should be given proton pump inhibitors. Okay. Now, one more thing you should. Suppose there is one patient who has long standing peptic ulcer, but it has not been diagnosed for as Zorringer-Allison and he is already on proton pump inhibitor. And you want to do secretin injection test, you have to stop proton pump inhibitor for at least 6 to 7 days, because long standing PPI increases gastrin level but reduces acid level. Okay. So, this is mandatory to stop PPI. However, when you are diagnosed the case of ZDS, you have to give PPI throughout the life unless you operate. Surgery is done for those tumor which are localized, but those who have metastasis, then surgery has not much role to play. Then you go for therapy like streptozotocin, 5-FU, interferon alpha or doxorubicin are given for disease which is widely spread via metastasis. This is all about Zorringer-Allison syndrome. Thank you very much.